Welcome to American Bible Society. Just a quick reminder, if you haven't done so already, you may want to turn off your cell phones or at least put them on vibrate. Tonight we, once again, are partnered with Crossroads, thank you very much, for bringing us George Marsden, Beyond Liberalism and Cultural Wars, a More Inclusive Pluralism. Carlo, Lancellotti will be our moderator tonight, and I'll let you take the floor.
Thank you. Okay, good evening. On behalf of Crossroads, I'm very pleased to introduce Professor Marsden, and I want to thank the American Bible Society for helping us organize this event. You know that recently Professor Marsden wrote a book, which has been the occasion for this invitation, about American culture in the 1950s and what it says about our contemporary situation. As you know, the 1950s often are remembered as a time when American culture enjoyed this remarkable monolithic consensus around traditional values like nuclear family, patriotism, religion. However, if you look closely, I think I interpret correctly Professor Marsden's insight, you can see that it was also a time when American culture embraced certain philosophical assumptions that the next decade, in the 1960s, would cause that same consensus to break down. So in his new book, The Twilight of the American Enlightenment, which is, I strongly recommend, it's very interesting, Professor Marsden gives a very fascinating reconstruction of the intellectual life of the 1950s. And it shows on the secular side how many people came to identify rationality with technocratic scientists and freedom with individual autonomy, which in a sense was a novelty with respect to the American tradition. On the religious side, many Christians came to accept what he calls a privatization of religion, which explains the paradox why American culture in that time could appear very religious and at the same time embrace some very anti-traditional practices. And as you, if you read the book, you will see that Professor Marsden regards this paradox as crucial in order to understand the 60s, what came in the next decade, and also the culture wars that from the 60s are going on until still today. And if I can make a comment, to me it's a reminder that a tradition cannot survive if it is taken for granted and it is not explored critically by putting into the test in all aspects of experience. I just want to give you a brief bio. Professor Marsden is the Francis A. McHenney Professor of History Emeritus at the University of Notre Dame. He holds degrees from Hereford College and Westminster Theological Seminary and a doctorate from Yale University. He is the author and editor of more than a dozen books and is certainly one of the most influential figures in evangelical scholarship and the Evangelical Academy of the Last Generation. He is regarded by many as one of the most indispensable writers, scholars, analysts, and teachers for the entire evangelical movement. I will just cite some of his more influential books, including Fundamentalism in American Culture, The Soul of American University, and his magisterial biography of Jonathan Edwards, titled Jonathan Edwards, The Life. So his latest work, as you see, is published by Basic Books, The Twilight of the American Enlightenment, The 1950s, and The Crisis of Liberal Belief. So let's welcome Professor Marsden.
Thank you so much, and it's a delight to be here and an honor to be with you and in talking about the cultural center here. Beforehand, I found out that the goals of the cultural center of integrating faith with all aspects of culture are very close to the preeminent goals of the Reformed Protestant tradition that I've been a part of. Reformed is or the Presbyterian, Dutch Reformed, German Reformed, etc. Tradition. So there's a lot of commonalities, I think, in our basic interests, and that probably explains why I got an invitation to come here. I've been asked to speak about this book, The Twilight of the American Enlightenment. It's subtitled The 1950s and the Crisis in Liberal Belief. And the book, as Carlo already has said, is a recounting of the mainstream popular cultural analysis of the 1950s. At the time, that was often called middle-brow sort of culture. And I was fascinated by that topic because I went to college in the 1950s. And so it was then that I first began to try to understand what makes American culture tick. How should you understand the basic dimensions of American life? And so I was reading a lot of this literature as a college student, and it set me on a course of trying to understand American culture, and particularly in relation to American religion, ever since. So I thought it would be fascinating to revisit that era over a half century later, to go back and see what the world looked like to the really astute commentators of that era. And it seems to me it's almost like revisiting, it's a lost era, like revisiting Cuba before the revolution. You're trying to, we know what was going to happen, but they didn't, and so then you look back and try to understand their outlook. 1950s is often looked back on by people as a time for considerable nostalgia. America was very prosperous in the 1950s. There was lots of religion and private and public culture. Family values were celebrated in the 1950s. And there's a widespread consensus that America stood for what's right and the Soviet Union stood for what's wrong in the world. And even if there were injustices in society, such as racial discrimination and so forth, there was hope for improvement that we're working on these issues. But the 1950s was also a time of some high anxieties. The major anxiety was the Cold War and at the same time the threat of the bomb. And it seemed very likely, if you thought of things realistically, that sometime this Cold War was going to break out into World War III. And this would be atomic warfare that would be unprecedented. People tried not to think about that, but I have in the book some New Yorker cartoons, and one of them is from the spring of 1960, and there's a woman who's in her front garden gardening, and she's looking up to her neighbor and saying, "The state that the world's in, probably all I'm planting is annuals." So the anxiety in the era ran deeper than politics and world affairs, and so my interest was trying to get into that deeper cultural commentary, and particularly there was pretty much agreement among cultural commentators that Americans had gotten too rich too quickly. And so there's a lot of worry about materialism. John Steinbeck wrote to his friend Adlai Stevenson in 1959, he said, "If I wanted to destroy a nation, I would give it too much, and I would have it on its knees, miserable, greedy, and sick." Too much technology was a particular concern, and particularly people were worried about television. That television suddenly had changed the culture. In the late 40s, television was rare. I remember watching the World Series in front of an electronic store window with a small crowd of people in 1948. By 1953, 5 years later, just about everybody had a television set. and people were watching the same, there were only three networks, and so everyone's watching the same shows and the same kind of shows, which were largely lowest common denominator. And so it's a very interesting discussion of what is television doing to American culture. Is it destroying American culture, and particularly high culture? Will mass culture drive out high culture? And even before television became so prominent, there was already a lot of worry in America about what they called at the time mass man. And mass man, mass humanity, was a 20th century invention. The classic work was a book by Eric Fromm called Escape from Freedom. And it appeared just in 1941, but it was very widely discussed and reprinted in the 1950s. And Fromm explained the rise of Nazism in terms of the rise of modernity gave people freedom, but it knocked down traditional values. But then freedom created new anxieties. People didn't know what to do with their freedom, and so the way to explain totalitarianism is that people turn from freedom to look for some new security in some totalitarian cause. And even without totalitarianism, cultural critics worried that Americans were subject to a kind of conformity of public opinion, that everyone wanted to do what everyone else was doing. And they looked at the suburbs, and everyone lives in the same kind of suburbs, the same kind of families, and the like. So there was a lot of worry about an alienation of the modern man people were losing their authenticity. So you get like the death of the salesman in the late 40s as an expression of that. Willie Loman just wants to be well-liked. Or when I went to college, big book that we were discussing in freshman year, I was Catcher in the Rye. And everybody wanted to be a nonconformist and to be against, be yourself, think for yourself. And there's a whole host of interesting cultural criticism. The Lonely Crowd by David Reisman came out in 1951 and was discussed by lots of people. Everyone talked about his categories of inner-directed man and outer-directed man and the like, sort of a variation, an American variation on the kind of theme that Fromm had developed. Or there's books like The Organization Man, worrying about the corporate conformity. Man in the Great Flannel Suit, the novel and the movie came out about the same time, gave a sort of, these were the catchwords. People were talking about The Organization Man or The Man in the Great Flannel Suit became almost cliches. So thoughtful people were worried in the 50s that this modern man, which meant modern men and women, had lost their way. But the problem was, well, what values can they present to put people back on a better course? And what most of the social commentators of that time believed was that we needed to get back to the best values of Western culture, the best in the West. Western civilization was standard in colleges. And because the Western world had just had this disaster in Nazism and World War II, so get back to the best Western values, and particularly in America, get back to the founding values of America, American free, democratic values, free American values. But that still left the problem of how to decide what's the best in the West, or the best American values. What if there's a conflict? And so I titled the book, The Twilight of the American Enlightenment, in order to signal that in the 50s, there's still a sense of continuity with the founding ideals of America, that they want to go back to the 18th century ideals that America was founded on, the basis for American freedom, that we fought World War II for, and so forth. But it's the twilight of the Enlightenment because in the 50s, the leading cultural commentators no longer shared the underlying philosophical assumptions of the 18th century thinkers, that particularly the faith that there was a natural law, a moral law, that everyone should be able to discover, because Darwinism and historicism and relativism had intervened in the intellectual world, and so people were left with more simply a pragmatic kind of philosophy that would pick and choose the best values that might work. And one of the most interesting episodes that I talk about in the book is has to do with Walter Lippmann. Walter Lippmann, as you know, was really the wisest cultural commentator since actually the teens in America. And in 1955, he published what was turned out to be his last book, called The Public Philosophy. And in it, one of the things he proposed was that if we're going to have a coherent public philosophy, we're going to have to get back to something like natural law. And what's interesting is that these pragmatists threw up their hands and said, you know, that's a Catholic thing. This leads to dogmatic ideologies and the like. And so, in a way, Lippmann, who's otherwise very revered by people like Arthur Schlesinger Jr., Archibald MacLeish, they sort of just dismiss Lippmann and dismiss this whole idea. But their view, I think, is probably best summarized in the title of Daniel Bell's book. It comes out at the end of the decade, called "The End of Ideology." That what they saw as the genius of the American way was that it avoided ideologies of the right or the left. Rather was pragmatic and picked and did one reform at a time, and was very practical in that regard. But the irony of that story is that the most successful and most important social reform of the era turned out to be the civil rights movement as led by Martin Luther King. And Martin Luther King was very explicitly against simply pragmatism. Pragmatism was what the moderates said, you know, don't go too fast. And in the letter from the Birmingham jail, King appeals to what? To natural, there's a natural moral law, and that's the thing we have to appeal to. Okay, so what were the mainstream, what I'm calling the liberal, and liberal didn't have the liberal sort of was this moderate position, neither right nor left at that time. What did they have to offer to cure the problems of modern man? And basically two things, I think. One was, since the common diagnosis was modern people are too much conformists, first theme that you find everywhere is be yourself, trust yourself, be an individual. And the second theme is at the same time, people needed to trust modern science and modern rationality. A good example, of that would be Dr. Spock, who became the standard for child rearing of the era. And he both is drawing on the scientific expertise of the day, but also he's saying to people in sort of an Emersonian way, trust yourself, trust your baby, you trust your own instincts. And that's a kind of classic outlook of the day. Well, at the same time that there are these almost ubiquitous ideas of individualism and trust in science, American culture had a lot of religion. It was the 1950s was a time of religious revival at just about any level, and certainly among Catholics. It was often looked back on as sort of the golden age of Catholicism. And there was lots of religion in public life. There's what we call civil religion. President Eisenhower referring to America's religious, the religious base of America is essential to the American experiment. It was also the era, it was the last era when there was still a Protestant establishment in the public culture, that even though Catholics were becoming very prominent in the culture, they hadn't made many inroads in the mainstream public culture. John Tracy Ellis wrote a classic about that in the mid-1950s. And there had been very strong prejudice against Catholics among some of the mainline Protestants. You might remember Paul Blanchard's book, American Freedom and Catholic Power, that came out in 1949 and widely read, caused a lot of controversy. During the decade of the 50s, there's more acceptance by this predominantly Protestant mainstream, sort of opening up to an idea of Protestant, Catholic, Jew. We're going to bring everyone into this mainstream and emphasizing the Judeo-Christian heritage rather than a particular more Protestant heritage. And of course, the election of John F. Kennedy in 1960 is an important signal of the ending of this Protestant dominance. And that brings me to the topic of the role of particular religious faiths in a diverse society, which is sort of the what I try to draw as the prescriptive, what's the moral of this story. How does this relate to issues of religion and American life in later decades? And so I'll give you a very quick run through of what I have to say on that. Starting in the 1950s, you can ask, well, what did pluralism mean in the 1950s? And it was a very important term. People, mainstream commentators, were very much aware of the wide diversity of American life. And pluralism meant bringing more and more people into the mainstream. It also, in order to do that, meant for these pragmatists avoiding ideological dogmatism and instead cultivating openness and empiricism. So irrational ideologies and dogmas, they said, would hurt democratic society, but accumulated scientifically based knowledge could help weed out the nonsense and folk beliefs. You can think about what was the message that sent to people who were coming from more conservative religious communities. And I think about this because I was coming from a conservative Protestant community, but it's very similar, and Catholics have written about the message to those communities. And the basic message was that if you were two things, if you should be autonomous and think for yourself, and you should trust modern science. And both of those ideas came with the implication that you should really move away from your original community into the American mainstream, into this consensus sort of culture. So that was the outlook about pluralism in the 1950s. Then, as you know, there's a cultural revolution of the 1960s and the 1970s. And one of the most conspicuous aspects of that change was that most of the mainstream culture begins to embrace diversity, ethnic diversity, and gender diversity, and racial diversity, and the like. For religion, the story isn't quite so simple. One of the things that happens in the 1960s is the rather rapid diminishment of the influence of the Protestant establishment in public affairs, that there's a reaction against the fact that Protestants had a monopoly. So the courts ruled against prayer in the public schools, which had a Protestant dimension to them. Or in the face of the countercultural criticisms of the 1960s, people are criticizing the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant establishment. A lot of mainline Protestants take that to heart and back away from cultural dominance. I've written about the history of religion in American universities, and a lot of Protestant universities and colleges drop their distinctive religious elements during that time. As far as American public life is concerned, by the time you get to the 1970s, the traditional Protestant voices that had been well represented in public life have been muted. So the dominant view is coming to be that in American politics and public discourse should be done without reference to any particular religious considerations. Basically what it does is move in the direction of emphasizing what has been around already in American life, and that is the privatization of American religion. That the way to deal with diversity is to privatize, to say it's fine to have your own personal religious beliefs, we're going to, you know, that's fine, or even if it's in public, if it doesn't amount to anything, I mean, if you can cross yourself when you score a touchdown and the like, but for substantive matters, keep it to yourself in the public domain. So even though by the 1970s, there are lots of public champions of diversity for racial, ethnic, sexual diversity, and the like, there aren't many people thinking about religion as a category for diversity. And instead, what you find is they're still thinking like the more secular thinkers of the 1950s in terms of assuming that what's called the secularization thesis, that as science and rationality advance, traditional religion will recede and disappear. And so public culture should become basically secular and no one's really looking out for the interests of religious communities. In response to that, we're left with what Richard Neuhaus called the naked public square, and you get the rise of the religious right. And make a long story short, the religious right is, particularly the fundamentalist side of it, is proposing to go back to what they call a Christian America, which is sort of to go back to the time of the Protestant establishment, but now it's going to be a more conservative Protestant establishment than it was in the 1950s, and it might include conservative Catholics and conservative Jews and a few others. And so there's in effect, the way the religious right is dealing with the problem of lack of religion in the public square is to say we should have a new establishment of a religiously based culture. And so as the era of the culture wars develops after 1980, none of the major parties in America really has a very well worked out theory of promoting a religiously pluralistic society as a matter of principle. And so you have the secularists on the one hand who are saying religion's going to fade away, we need a secular culture, and you have various religious people who are trying to reestablish religion's dominance in the culture. But there isn't a real theory of pluralism. So in the concluding portion of this book, I suggest what I have here in the title, a more inclusive pluralism. And in the book itself, I argue that from my own Protestant perspective. But one thing I think I lack there is giving reasons why other people should adopt pluralism as a matter, religious pluralism as a matter of principle. And so I'll just very quickly suggest some reasons why I think Americans in general ought to see that if you're talking about pluralism in a society, if you're celebrating diversity, then it always should involve taking seriously religious diversity as one of the kinds of diversity that needs to be valued and to be preserved. And the general reasons I think that one can give for that, I guess give three. One is simply a matter of justice. Religious communities should not be discriminated against just because of the peculiarity of their religiously based views. So for instance, a good example would be Catholic and other parochial schools that serve sub-communities. I think it would make sense to have tax support. Why doesn't that happen? Well, because of the long Protestant dominance, there was anti-Catholic prejudice and the public schools were effectively Protestant schools. But if you had pluralism as a principle, then you'd say we should value all sorts of schools, secular schools, Protestant schools, religious, Catholic schools, Jewish schools, and the like. So as a matter of equity, one should promote diversity in the culture for religious communities. Second, such principles of justice are consistent with the American Constitution. And that sometimes is recognized. I think it's the basis for the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. But that idea is, as you know, much assailed in the culture today, but I think it's a good argument for the constitutional basis for recognizing this sort of diversity. I just read a very nice piece from Professor Richard Garnett at Notre Dame. He sent me arguing that from a Catholic point of view. And then finally, I think you can also present a really strong pragmatic argument for why diversity, religious diversity, should be valued and cultivated as a matter of principle. And that I can say is, in my role as a historian, that I think a fair history of the United States, from almost any point of view, will yield the fact that religious subcommunities have done tremendous work for the culture in general in cultivating morally responsible citizens. And so, yeah, even people who think that traditional religion is totally benighted should recognize that even so, there's lots of people that, who may admire in American culture. I think most of the great reformers in American history have strong religious backgrounds. Many of them may have given up their original traditional faith, but they carry with them the moral fervor that they were taught in their religious subcommunity. So I see religious communities as producing moral capital for the whole society. And that seems to me then to be a pragmatic reason to say religious communities ought to be valued and cultivated rather than to be treated as though they're second class, or their educational systems are second class systems and the like, but rather they should be valued. The way I interpret this history, that even though the United States has a wonderful tradition of religious freedom and tolerance, it doesn't have a very strong tradition of religious pluralism. That is, Catholics were tolerated throughout American history, but with a lot of prejudice for most of the history, because Protestants tended to run things. So Protestants weren't really developing a theory that all religions should be treated equally. They're just saying they should be tolerated. And then that kind of establishment is succeeded by a more secular religious establishment that basically says we want to treat all religions equally, but it's really best if they sort of fade from the picture. So in sum, my basic message is in getting beyond liberalism or culture wars approach is to have consciousness raising that whenever we speak of pluralism or diversity, we need to take seriously that we're thinking about and speaking about religious diversity and religious diversity of all sorts. Thank you.